Hello and welcome to Chamber Connections. I'm Maureen Sullivan, and today's guest is Mara Breer. She is the founder and owner of Grow a Stronger Family. Mara, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So let's start with, what is Grow a Stronger Family?
Grow a Strong Family is a family life education company which provides services for families in Bedford and surrounding towns, which include everything from parenting education to family coaching, where I work with families on customized solutions to whatever problems they have.
Awesome. So tell me how, first of all, before we talk about what you specifically do, how you got into this. You obviously have a family.
I do.
You have a family, a good family. So what is your background in? And I see you have a lot of letters after your name. So what are those for?
I have a master's in family life education. I also have a pending master's in therapeutic recreation, and I have a bachelor's degree in philosophy and sociology, and somewhere in there, I have a variety of certifications in elementary education, a parenting program called Parenting with Love and Logic, Myers-Briggs Type Inventory, which is a personality-based system, motivational interviewing, substance abuse counseling. I have a variety of skills.
You got everything covered.
I have lots of things covered.
That's good.
I have lots of interests.
So have you done this your whole life, or is this something after you raised your own children that you got into?
I started early, probably wanting to fix my own original family, and found that I couldn't, which most of us figure out pretty early. But what I am fascinated by is how families develop strengths, and I want to be a partner with families on how they do this. Try to give families skills so that they have the best opportunities to have resilience, to overcome challenges, and to have good quality of life, to have fun. One of the things that I do is I work with families that have children with issues, children without issues, older kids, younger kids, and give them joy. Mm-hmm. Give them the opportunity to have joy. Sometimes raising children, especially in these days, is extremely difficult. How do you get over that?
Right. So do the people come to you, is it kind of like marriage counseling? Like, unfortunately, you probably should go to marriage counseling before you need it. And that's probably why I'm having on my show, so that people can come to you before they really are in crisis.
That's typically when you would come to somebody like me. Usually you go see a therapist after the problems have set in. You come to see somebody like me before the problems set in. I want to I'm a preventer. Even if problems are coming up or they've already set in, my role is to stabilize. My role is to take you from where you are here and move forward. If I discover with you that you actually have more deep-rooted issues, I'll make a referral. Mm-hmm. Or if you're already in therapy and you really need skills, my job is to help you develop those skills, and I'll work collaboratively with your therapist. But I don't do therapy except short-term prevention-based therapeutic work.
And so what kind of programs do you offer?
I offer parenting education, couples communication, individual communication, family transitions for families that are separated or divorced, substance abuse counseling, and if families have children who are mentally ill, I will work with them. Usually it's around psychoeducation, which is gobbledygook for learning how to manage a child who has a behavioral health issue. You still have to be the best parent you can be, and you still have to parent. So those are the parameters around what I do. I'll work with parents around basic issues. How do I raise my 3-year-old when they have a tantrum? How do I deal with my 19-year-old who was just diagnosed with bipolar?
Right. So let's talk a little bit about parenting, having had 3 children and still have 3 children.
I hope so.
Well, they're grown-ups now, but they're still children. So from your experience, what do you think is the most important thing in parenting? The most important thing to make you a good parent?
I think the most important thing to be a good parent is to maintain your sense of humor.
I agree.
I really think that's the most important thing. If you take everything they do personally, you will go to every fight you're invited to, and that will make you ineffective, and it'll reinforce how incompetent you feel as a parent, because nothing makes us feel less competent than parenting. Mm-hmm. So maintaining your sense of humor allows you to do the job of picking and choosing your battles. Yeah. Right. And then you can become effective at the battles you do have to go to.
So nowadays, parents have been, they've been defining them as like helicopter parents. I mean, when you look at the difference between how my generation, us, I don't know where you are in relation to me, how we were raised with kind of hands-off parenting. You know, your parents never came to a, I know in my case, you know, I played 4 years of athletics in high school and college. My parents never spoke to a coach, never, didn't even know the coach's name. They didn't know my parents. I've coached for 25 years, and I mean, I've had in-depth conversations with parents, good and bad, in my house, on my phone, you know, that kind of thing. So how do you think that switched, and what are the, you know, the ramifications of that? Like, is it true that we're raising these, like, you know, kids that can't, you know, get themselves out of a brown paper bag, as I call them?
I think what we've done is we've gone from parents who had the attitude that children were responsible for their own lives, mm-hmm. to almost to an extent that that parents were neglectful, mm-hmm. to such a hands-on extent that parents are not that parents are overly responsible for their children's lives, and children are entitled guests in their own homes.
Right.
I think that we need to be in a middle ground. I think parents need to be helping their children acquire skills and tools so they can advocate on their own behalf and assume responsibility for themselves. So yeah, get to know the coach. But get to know the coach in the sense of advocating, helping your child learn how to advocate on his or her own behalf. But also identifying the coach as the person in charge, the teacher as the person in charge. By constantly stepping in, you are disallowing your child from assuming the responsibility for the relationships that they need to have. Think of it this way. What kind of employee are you allowing the child to ultimately become? Because no boss is going to keep an employee that doesn't know how to speak up for themselves.
Right. Or has their mother call.
Well, one of the things that colleges are now saying when they are looking at the applications is, I don't know who's writing the papers. Sure. So we can't go by that, because we don't know if the parent has hired somebody or the parent wrote it. Right. So we have to look at test scores, which really isn't fair, because not every kid is a good test taker.
Sure.
So that's not reasonable either.
Now, do you think there'll be a swing back? I know that in my family, my son is about to have his first child, and he's informed me that he's going to make him more responsible than he is.
Yeah, you've had that's nice to hear.
You've had such a bad life, you want to make your, you know, whatever. But do you think that will happen, like, overall, like, you know, as our children grow up, they'll see that they probably had it a little too easy, or they, you know, they weren't quite as responsible as they should have been?
From what I'm seeing, I do see more of a swing back, because mm-hmm. what I see in my practice is that I'm getting more parents who are buying into the parenting programs that I subscribe to, which are basically saying, how do we teach our children from an early age to assume responsibility for themselves? And it goes all the way up. When I work with parents of teenagers and they're all sweating, how do I get my child to fill out their college applications in time? And I say to them, if your child doesn't know how to fill out his application in time, he's not ready to go to college.
Right. Right.
It's really that simple.
Right.
He can go to community college for a year and figure it out.
Well, don't you think a lot of times with parents, it's because it's an extension of their ego? Like, it's not really, the reason why they want their kids to go to college is they don't want them not to go to college, because it's a reflection on them?
I don't think it's ego. I think it's that, I don't really think it's a reflection of their ego. I think it's the message that they've accepted, that somehow they're responsible for their children's decisions, and they're afraid mm-hmm. for their children to make mistakes, as if it's going to ruin their lives forever. And one of the things that I usually remind parents of is that this is America. It is okay to go to college a year or two later if necessary, if your child needs that time. And they often do.
Right.
Or if they're in college and they need to take a break, or even let's take a younger age. If they make a mistake when they're younger, they'll learn from it. And think of how valuable that learning is when it's not life-threatening.
Right, right.
If they can learn from those mistakes at earlier ages, then they'll have that much wisdom, they'll do that much better, we won't have to worry as much.
Right.
They're making life-threatening mistakes at a much earlier age now. Let's help them not make those mistakes.
I would think that in your job or in your profession, it would be wonderful to really reach out to people like when their children are young. I mean, obviously, it's more difficult to rewrite history. You know, when you have the teenagers who have never, had any responsibility, had no money, financial. Whereas if you start in those young, toddlers or even first grade, second grade. So do you go out and pursue that? Like, I mean, this will help in the show, like all those people in Bedford now having children are going to be calling up Mara going, gotta talk to her. Do you do your marketing that way, or do you just throw it out there and see who comes?
I throw it out there and see who comes. It's much easier if the parents are younger, yes. It also is the parenting age group that tends to be targeted by Department of Education dollars. But the parents in need are your parents of middle school kids and your high school kids. And those are the children in need, too. That's also when we usually start seeing children who are experimenting with alcohol and drugs and sex. Those are the children we see that are engaging in more high-risk behavior. And those are the ages of children that are starting to have some of the mental health issues.
Well, it's interesting because I've always felt that, the whole issue of being at home, working, being there for your kids. And I've always felt if you want to work, you should work while your kids are 0 to 12. And, everyone says, oh, I stayed home with my kids till they went to second grade or third grade. And I'm thinking, yeah, and then you threw them to the wolves because, really, children need us the most between 12 and 18. Maybe in this day, 22. It's been extended a little bit. But, people don't see that because most parents are like, oh, I got to nurture and be around from 0 to 5 when, I don't really see that.
And in my field, I would concur with you.
Yeah.
I think that really they really need you in the teenage years because that's when they need the supervision, that's when they need the role modeling, that's when they need the ride from point A to point B. That's when they need the conversations, that's when they need the open-ended questions, who, what, when, where. Stay away from why, please. All you get from why is because. You want the open-ended questions. Well, why do you, how did that decision affect you? What were, if you say to them, what were you thinking? They will say, I don't know. And they really don't know because they're having the second biggest plunge of brain activity since their toddler years. That's what's going on in the teenage years. They do need you then. Absolutely.
Right. I like that. Who, what, when?
Who, what, when, where? Stay away from why.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
That's good. All right, so I have on my little cheat sheet here that you also offer pet therapy services.
Yes,
so
I do.
So what's the name of your pet and what do they therapize? That's a good word.
Therapize. My dog's name is Max. He's an 18-month-old Pyrenees Springer mix. He's about 50 pounds. And we were trained through Dog Bones Pet Therapy, which is dogs building opportunities for nurturing and emotional support. And he comes with me. One of the things that I provide as a service is I work with families either in my home offices here in Bedford or I go to you so I can come to your house. And Max and I will often come to people's houses. So he will work with your children or you. I have a couple who love to have the greeting when they come to the door. And we bring toys for him to engage with. And he will often get children in particular talking about what's going on in their lives. And just in the course of play. And what's nice about that is that I get an insight into what's going on in the family without having anybody have to feel as though they're under a microscope. Mm-hmm. And Max just helps to get everybody to relax and calm down. He's exhausted by the end of a session, needless to say, but it just helps soothe things over. We also volunteer at Tewksbury Hospital on the brain injury unit.
Oh, nice.
So that's all he has to do there is get pet.
Right.
That's his main job.
Right.
But I've had him trained so he does tricks too.
Awesome. And why isn't Max here today?
Because he's at day camp.
Day camp?
Day camp. I sent him to day camp at PetSmart in Chelmsford one day a week so he gets to just socialize with other dogs and play.
Well, so not only are you a good mother parent, you're a good dog parent.
I am a good pet parent, yes.
Yes, that's awesome.
So that's one of the things that he does. And he signs up for some of the colleges during finals time and midterms. They ask for pet therapy pairs to come and help some of the college students control their stress levels. So sometimes we volunteer and help out with that. And again, all he has to do is show up and let college sure. students fawn over him.
Right.
And he's very good at that. He lets them do that.
It's not a bad thing.
But I have clients who sometimes come to my house. I've had estranged parents come to my house and take advantage of a family transitions program that I've created for divorcing parents on how to be good parents, mm-hmm. even though they are not good partners. And they,
now, do both the people come or just one of the partners?
Both of them came.
They both come. So a divorced couple who are now going to try and parent their children.
And
separately.
They both come, yeah. and they try to remain civil to each other. That's a rule that I make.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes things get very intense, and there will be tears flowing. Max will go right up to them and put his head on their lap and just stand there while they pet him.
Wow.
And it kind of diffuses the whole environment.
Right.
It's a nice piece, which is kind of what I wanted when I was looking at a dog and thinking, I want a dog that's going to be an adjunct to,
sure.
to my practice.
And how long have you had Max?
Since he's 4 months old, so 14 months. He's only
oh, wow.
a year and a half.
Wow.
He's very young for the work, but he's yeah. a natural.
And your children, how many children do you have?
I have a 25-year-old daughter.
Who does an only child.
An only child, and she's actually going to Leslie for expressive arts therapy.
Awesome. I do like that. And what does she think of your profession? Like, does she give you comments, feedback?
She hated it as a child, she would say, at various times, mm-hmm. she would say, I hate having a parent who understands about adolescent development. She said, because she would say it's hard to be a rebellious right. teenager yeah. when you have a parent who understands.
Sure.
At other times, she would tell me, I can't believe parents listen to you.
Right.
And then at other times, she would say, does this stuff work on boyfriends? How about roommates?
Yeah.
So at various times, now she appreciates it because now she's entering the right. field, I mean, from a different aspect.
Plus she's an adult.
And now
we
she's
know
an
that
adult.
It, as a parent, we know eventually children agree that, yes, we actually do know what we're doing most of the time and that we're not
right.
as crazy
so,
as they thought we were.
And
yes.
at 25 is, I find, a nice age.
Right.
I mean, you know, 16 was tough, but 16 is tough for every parent.
Right.
They're starting to drive.
Well, I think 16, yeah, I think for boys, 16 or 17 is tough. I think for girls now it's like 13 and 14, and 12, 13, you know, that whole...
12 to 14 right now is a tough age.
It's tough for girls, but...
Yeah.
Girls are tough anyway.
That's what I thought. As soon as I found out I was having a girl, I spent the weekend grieving.
Yes, but she'll be with you for, you know, because they say that thing, you know, girls will stay around, so that's fine.
And that's what the research informs us.
Yes. Well, Mara, this was very interesting. I'm really glad you came, and I hope you get some clients out of this. I think you will, because I think that there are a lot of people out there looking for assistance. And like you said, parenting isn't something I've always said that they should have a throwaway child. Like, there should be a child that gets passed around to all parents, because we all know, like, that first child, it's surprising that and first children even grow up and can live, because all our expectations, all our worries, everything are just in that kid. So even now, as I said, I have three children. My oldest child, I still have this little, like, I'm so sorry what I did to you when you were young. You know, I want everything, like, right from the get-go. But, you know, there are obviously parents now take it very seriously, and we'll, I hope, call you and ask you for your assistance, because you have so much to offer.
One other thing that I do, just so that people know, is I also do telephone and computer conferencing.
Awesome.
And I provide services between sessions. So I don't just say, hey, I'll see you next week, good luck.
Mm-hmm.
I expect people to stay in touch with me. It's part of the service. It's part of what they're paying for. And I don't charge extra for it. So
I probably should ask you that. I want to say, how much did you charge by the hour? Do you charge, like, you know, by the session? How do you charge?
I charge by the session. And, for example, if you're doing face-to-face, it would mm-hmm. be $65 for the face-to-face session. But I expect to hear from you between sessions. That's included in mm-hmm. that fee, so it's not extra.
Right.
I have a different fee for telephone and for computer conferencing, and that would be something that we would be negotiating. But I always, I mean, my attitude is, you're getting skills, you're getting support, I'm your coach, I'm in your back pocket, I'm here for you.
Right.
I want you to do it right. And I don't charge for that because that's what we're here to work on together.
So when you go to someone's house, all I can think of is that wonderful nanny from Nanny 911 or whatever. And she gives them, like, you know, tasks, whether it be, you know, here's a list of what you can do or you have to have a timeout. Do you do the same sort of thing so people actually have some, you know,
I do the same sort of thing. And then I say, if you practice this, if you experiment with this, call me, let me know how it's going.
Sure.
And that way, if we need to tweak it, we tweak it. I don't want to wait a week.
Right.
I want to find out as you're doing it because I don't want you to get into any bad habits.
Right.
Let's see how this goes. And then when I see you next week, we'll talk about more and then we'll do more. This is designed to be not a forever service. It's designed to be 3 to 6 months.
Good.
That's it.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much for coming. And you can get information on, I'm going to say it right, Grow a Strong Family. I said Grow a Stronger Family. Grow a Strong Family at the Chamber website at www.bedfordchamber.org. So thank you again and have a great day.
Thank you and thanks for having me.
You're welcome.